We have two fantastic speakers. I'm sure you guys know them. They'll tell more about themselves in a little bit. And we've already lost some time, so we're going to have to, we're not really considering it. We're just going to have to follow the rules, and hopefully we can get through it, and then still provide opportunities toward the end where we can actually have an open mic, and you guys can ask questions, and then we have the next person that we will, you guys can write questions and submit them to us. In a little bit, they'll introduce themselves, and it's going to start off with 10-minute intervals where they're going to present the evidence for whether it's creation or evolution, and then they're going to have a section, a 5-minute section rebuttal, 5-minute cross-examination, and then we're also going to dive into morality, and they're going to talk about morality and how that plays in. So we're going to talk. They're going to have 10 minutes to present their perspectives on morality, and then finally. So if we add up all that time, it's going to be an hour and 10 minutes, which will be perfect. We're going to have lots of time for open questions, open mic. In order to make the hour and 10 minutes, we're going to have to be quiet. As you can see, it's a really small room, and. Just the smallest conversation might interrupt, you know, people listening or up front might interrupt the debate itself. So we're going to need to silence. You will have opportunities to ask questions later, so no outbursts and no questions in the middle of, you know, them presenting their arguments for or against. And then we're going to have closing statements. So with that being said, I would like to introduce Bernie. You guys can go ahead and applause.
I've had some copies of a handout. I'll give these copies here. That's an extra one you can have that. You can pass these around. I had a 100 and I ran out, so sorry about that. I didn't get one. Okay, so first I want to say thanks for inviting me to this debate. I'm happy to see such a big turnout. I do these debates actually quite frequently in the West Side Science and Religion Discussion Group at Evergreen Presbyterian Church. And if you go to meetup.com, you can and search for Christian or atheist, you'll see a lot of these debates. I'm a former born-again evangelical Christian. I was one for 25 years. I preached the gospel on the internet and local cable TV. I started a 501c3 preaching ministry, and I got a seminary degree while I was working full-time in the computer industry. I still work full-time in the computer industry. And I'd also like to introduce Ben Crockett in the audience in case later on. He's a biology expert finishing up his degree, so if we have any questions about biology. I want to say I know what it feels like to have a relationship with Jesus. I felt like I had that. I know what it feels like to be led by God, and I now think that was a delusion. And tonight, we're going to talk about two different philosophies. I hope to represent the finest in academic naturalistic thinking. It's called metaphysical naturalism, also known as philosophical naturalism. And Eric Holden will represent a subset of religious thinking, Christianity, and even more than that, a subset of Christian theology called young earth creationism. I not only oppose young earth creationism, but also any kind of divinely inspired Christian theology. I don't represent all atheists, but I do hope to represent secular humanism well. My definition of that is secular humanism is a naturalistic belief system that promotes critical thinking and morality by way of modern science and reason. So I hope you can hold me accountable for that I'm using reason for all my opinions. And so I'd like to offer the secular humanism as a replacement for your own religion. And I also want to make an appeal to you to make a personal commitment to follow the truth regardless of where it leads. And with that, we'll go on.
Thank you, Bernie. And this is, let's introduce Eric Hovind.
It's an absolute pleasure to be here. I want to thank Portland State University and Bernie, who we'll be talking with throughout the evening, for the opportunity to come here and discuss these ideas, the philosophies the things that ultimately govern our lives. We know that what we believe determines how we behave. The way you think about something will impact the way you live that something out. And so it really is an important concept. It really is important to understand what you believe and why you believe it. I obviously am going to represent my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I pray that I do so with all humility and at the same time confidence, because I know that He is God. We'll be talking about the concepts. A lot of this is going to get into really some philosophical arguments. So I hope you brought your thinking caps. We're going to kind of have to dive in a little bit deep here as we discuss evidence and morality. My argument obviously is going to be that without God you cannot have these things. And so I look forward to bringing to you guys some very good information. I realize that in a debate setting, most people come here with their minds made up. They know exactly what they believe, why they believe it, and they don't want to change anything. There may be a few out there that are just on the fence going, well, I'm curious what somebody's going to say here that might change my mind one way or another. So I realize that for the most part, I don't expect Bernie at the end of the night to say, wow, white flag, I'm wrong, I'm sorry. And I certainly am not going to wave a white flag and say, wow, God doesn't exist. So going into this, I realize that we've kind of got our minds made up. My goal is to try to present some facts, some information to you that will make you go, oh my goodness, to deny God is to be reduced to foolishness. To deny God is to be reduced to foolishness. And I don't say that in a way of trying to call a name. I'm saying intellectually, it would be foolish to deny that God exists. And that's what I'll stand for this evening. Thank you guys for being here.
Thank you. We're going to have Bernie. He's going to be presenting the evidence that he has today. Back to the format. We're going to have each debater is going to have 10 minutes to delivering their proofs, their arguments, and then following those two, they're going to be each other cross-examining and asking each other to respond and rebutting each other. So we're going to start with Bernie, and he's going to have the floor for 10 minutes. And then it'll be Eric's turn.
Okay, and we have a little bit misunderstanding of that about what the debate's about, because me and Eric didn't even have any email conversation, and we both only found out about 2 days ago that I'm going to be doing this. So we'll do the best we can here. I'm taking a totally different track. I'm not here to talk about the evidence for evolution, but I'm going to talk about what some of the issues are here. So basically, there's these origins questions. How did the universe begin? How did chemicals appear? Biological life, how did that arise? Much of this is still being researched and discovered. And probably the one that has most answers out of all of them is probably the chemical evolution, about basically chemicals are created from the chemical elements of stellar thermonuclear fusion of a supernova. So when a star goes supernova, that's when it blows out a whole bunch of elements. So basically all these chemicals are made in the furnace of stars. And if you want to learn more about science on that, I would start, say, you know, maybe read some of these dummy books. Like, there's Chemistry for Dummies here. They're highly technical. They're not written by dummies. They're for dummies. So I mean, it's written for the average layperson. And, you know, organic chemistry, I don't have a degree in that, and I haven't really studied it, so it's very detailed. Some things I want to talk about is the importance of evolutionary thinking. It's a lot more than just biology. It starts with cosmological evolution from the Big Bang, how planets evolved, or planets came to be after the super hot plasma came to cool. That led to biological evolution, which is talking about life on Earth. And then also there's mimetic evolution, which is the evolution of ideas from humans and animals too. You know, so if you project in the future, another 100,000, maybe 100 years, 1,000 years, a million years, and we could be on this planet for millions of years if we take care of it. I don't believe Jesus is coming back tomorrow. You know, robots are going to be sentient beings, maybe a different kind of sentient, but they'll be aware. Like right now, there's a computer that can win at Jeopardy called Watson. There's Deep Blue that could beat at chess. There's the Google car that drives itself. Put all those three things into an iPhone app, you're still talking about the very basics of computing power. So And that kind of gets into mimetic evolution. So no, I don't believe there's a ghost in the machine. There's no ghost in us. We are what they call meat-based computers, if you want to think of it that way. Evolution, as I said, is a grand scheme. It displaces all other creation myths. There's a professor named Ursula Goodenough. She pioneered this ethic of evolution class in her university to teach about how it starts from cosmological evolution and goes all the way through mimetic evolution. And she has experts come in and talk about cosmology and different parts, and she's a biology expert. Okay, why are we talking about this topic? Well, because this is one of the best evidences for God, and this is the philosopher's God, I would say. This is the difference between, you got to define what kind of God you're talking about. Are you talking about Zeus or Yahweh, who's the God of Israel, or Jesus, who's said to be one of, he's not the Father, he's the Son, but there's only one God, but he's God, that kind of confusion. And then there's, for example, the Catholics, Roman Catholics think the wafer is literally Jesus Christ after the priest consecrates it. So there's a lot of different kind of gods, and so when you talk about origins as evidence for God, we're talking about the philosopher's God. It's like, it's not from the Bible, it's from philosophy. How did everything come to be? And so why isn't he talking about the biblical God? I'd say there's no evidence for it whatsoever. And I would say beware of his tactics. I think he's going to bring up where there's cherry picking. For example, there's a grand scheme of evidence for all of evolution. And I think what Eric is going to do is going to say, well, look at this anomaly here. How do you explain this? And if I did have an explanation, he's going to say, what about this anomaly? So it's not a matter of trying to pick out anomalies to prove what you want to be true. It should be about looking at the facts and putting the best curve fit to what would explain those facts. There's lots of fellow Christians that could debunk Eric's younger creationism. There's, for example, Reasons to Believe Ministries with Hugh Roth are older. They don't accept evolution, but they accept the age of the universe. Eric thinks the Earth was made before the sun and only a few thousand years ago, rather than billions of years ago. There's also BioLogos, an evangelical group who's trying to struggle to integrate evolution and theology, and the ASA, American Scientific Affiliation, is another one of Christians in Science. Some creationists also mislead or lie. For example, in my seminary I went to, they used Michael Denton's book, Evolution, A Theory in Crisis. Well, then after I graduated, I found out that Michael Denton doesn't have a problem with humans evolving from animals. He just has a problem with some of the mechanisms of evolution. So you got to be careful about how they represent things, especially like even intelligent design from the Discovery Institute. Michael Behe is one of the leaders in that, and he says he doesn't have a problem with humans evolving from animals. He just thinks God did a miracle to create some things like the basics of the cell. The biggest thing I think that Eric's going to talk about is that it's using a God of the gaps theology. He can say, like, how did the universe come to be? We don't know. Therefore, that's evidence of God. No, it's not evidence for God. Oh, but look how precisely tuned it is. That's evidence for God. No, it's not. If you don't know the answer, it's not evidence for God. That's like a caveman saying, who did the lightning? I don't know. That's evidence for God. No, we know now it's electrical differences. Who caused the earthquake? I don't know, but obviously God. I don't think so. Well, then who? Well, I think it must be God. Well, if you don't know, it must be God. Well, it's not. It's plate tectonics, and they caused tsunamis also. So it's the same way about what created the universe. There's no reason to jump to God did it. It's just God of the gaps thinking. Who came up with this idea of calling it God of the gaps? Actually, a theologian, Henry Drummond, and also some other theologians are also recommending that. They're saying it's bad for science. It's bad thinking. Personally, I think for the origin of the universe, my best guess, Eric has a video, he says, atheists think, you take a big box of nothing and add some time and maybe add some more time and kaboom, there's everything. Well, I don't believe that. I actually think multiverse theory has a lot of merit. This universe was birthed from something else. This idea is something a lot of leading-edge physicists are thinking about. It's based in string theory, which is also leading-edge physics, but not proven yet. So it's based in some math and based in science, and it's not based in, oh, God did it. And
So, you know, with strength theory, they think there might actually be even 11 dimensions and not 4. We're used to the 4, the length, width, height, and time. Well, there may be up to 11 or more. So this is what they're dealing with math. And if there's 11 dimensions, obviously we can't comprehend that. So don't jump to God did it just because we're ignorant. And another person says, another atheist I know, he says, you know, it's perfectly fine to say I don't know. That's not a weakness. You know, you can't say, hey, it's superior to say God did it to I don't know. It's not superior. It's just superstitious thinking. So Eric thinks that the universe is only about 6,000 years old or so. Some of the biggest problems is that it's the apparent age problems. For example, God made Adam, and, you know, here he is ready to reproduce. How old is he? He looks like he's 18 or so, but, you know, he's only 1 day old or 2 days old. You can't trust your eyes. Even worse, more obvious, is there's a supernova that was observed to explode. It's SN2008D. And they said it's 88 million light years away, which means it took 88 million years for that light to come here. So we're seeing what happened 88 million years ago. According to Eric, that never happened because God only made the universe about 6,000 years ago. So if that really happened, it's like God made an illusion. Hey, look at this movie out here. It never really happened, but it's a movie, you know. It makes God a liar, you know. So part of the solution here is understanding from a scientific viewpoint what Richard Dawkins calls middle world. We evolved in this middle world. That's why we don't understand the small things, like on the nanoscale level. We don't know what it's like to see an atom with all that empty space in there. We don't know what it's like to be on the grand scale, the large world, where things are measured in thousands of light years or millions of light years. We can't even comprehend one light year. So a lot of this stuff is humbling as you learn more about science. Another profound idea for scientific understanding I think would help in this realm is an idea from emergence from Professor Cyril Goodenough again. Basically, it says how life emerges. And if you replay the tape of life, you have a different situation. For example, we may be here because an asteroid hit and wiped out the dinosaurs. If history happened all over again, that asteroid may not hit, or a different one had hit a different place, and we'd end up in a different situation here. So here we find ourselves. This is how everything emerged. Who are you? Well, you're an idea of emergence. I mean, you are the person you are because of who you're raised with, where you live, and all this stuff, you know? If you take identical twins, and they'd be different people. Okay, so just let me end with one thing, and that is that the Bible has an ancient science and an ancient Hebrew cosmology, and this is the problem. I think Eric still thinks this is modern science, and it's not.
All right, thank you, Bernie. Now we're going to have Eric Hovind. He's going to present his perspective and arguments for creation and evolution.
Excellent. Well, I hate to disappoint Bernie, but no, I'm not going to take that kind of approach. I'd like to take a completely different approach to this debate. First of all, I need to define who God is, because a lot of people have a misunderstanding or misconception of exactly who God is. The God I'm going to be defending is the God of the Bible. He can be defined this way. God is a spirit, infinite, eternal, and unchangeable in his being, wisdom, power, holiness, justice, goodness, and truth. That is the God that I'm going to be defending. It's the God that's talked about in the Bible, in the scripture, which is God's revelation or God's revealed word to mankind. My testimony is I grew up in a Christian home. I grew up becoming a product of my environment. I faked Christianity for 23 years. It wasn't until the age of 23 years old, after growing up in an incredible Christian home, that I truly accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior. God granted me repentance, took out my heart of stone, and gave me a heart of flesh, and I've been a brand new creature in Christ Jesus since the age of 23 years old. I need to define a worldview also, because your worldview determines how you look at the evidence. This debate, the very beginning of this, is supposed to be about evidence, and so your worldview is going to determine how you view evidence. A worldview is a network of our most basic beliefs about reality, from which we interpret all of our observations. That's what I'm classifying as a worldview. I actually come across quite a few atheists who say, I used to be a Christian. I want to challenge that right away. You can't say, I used to be a Christian. To say, I used to be a Christian assumes that God does exist. You could instead say, I used to be delusional. That would be consistent with what your worldview is now saying. But you cannot say, I used to be a Christian. It would be like me saying, you know, I had a wonderful marriage that lasted for 13 years. My wife and I even had 3 absolutely beautiful children. Until I found out that my wife wasn't real. That doesn't make any sense. You cannot say, I used to be a Christian. By the way, the Bible is very clear about this, Bernie. Those that left us were never among us. So it's impossible to claim that I used to be a Christian. Here's just a simple reasoning analogy to show you the fact that you cannot say that. As a Christian, my ultimate authority is God. That is my ultimate authority. In other words, Christ is the head of my reasoning. I take every thought into captivity and make it obedient to Christ. If you don't believe in God, of course the things we believe in are nuts. I mean, to believe that a man walked on water, that a virgin gave birth, that people walked around the city and the walls fell down, that doesn't make sense without God. I get that. I totally understand that. But to say I used to be a Christian, as a Christian, our ultimate authority, including authority over our ability to reason, is Christ. How can you go from a position where Christ is the head of your reasoning to a position where you are the head of your reasoning? I submit to you that that is an impossibility. There's no such thing as I used to be a Christian. You can't read verses like Romans 8, 38 and 39. I am persuaded that neither death nor life nor angels nor principalities nor powers nor things present nor things to come nor height nor depth nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. And then go out and say, well, I guess I was wrong. No, then you never believed that to begin with. Bernie, by the way, is a product of a man-centered gospel. If you watch his testimony, he is the product of a man-centered gospel and not the true gospel. He never turned his reasoning over to God. Because if you had, you could never go back from that. If Christ is the head of your reasoning, you can never go back to you being the head of your reasoning. Now, this debate is supposed to be over evidence. Let me tell you what evidence is. Evidence is your basis for belief or disbelief. It's knowledge on which to base belief. It's the available body of facts or information indicating whether a belief or proposition is true or valid. Do a quick dictionary search that I just did, and I did a screenshot real quick here for you. The available body of facts or information indicating whether a belief or position is true or valid. That's what evidence is. Well, evidence, you notice here that it says, hey, it's the available body of facts to indicate whether or not something is true. Well, if evidence shows us what is true, then what does truth mean? Evidence, the very idea of evidence, assumes truth, doesn't it? Here's the problem. Evidence assumes knowledge. Knowledge is justified true belief, by the way. Truth is that which conforms to the mind of God. Without this, you cannot give a definition of what truth is. Or you resort to what most atheists do when they say there is no such thing as truth. Knowledge assumes truth. Evidence assumes that truth exists. As I was walking into PSU here today, I noticed that over the walkway where people drive all the time, let knowledge serve the city. It's interesting, because knowledge assumes that truth exists. How can you have knowledge without truth? It's amazing how many times I hear atheists say, we don't know anything. And I'll ask them, do you know that? That in itself is a truth claim. I'm glad Bernie actually talks on a regular basis about how he was in a pursuit for truth. When you watch his testimony, it says, going into this search, his search to kind of destroy atheism when he said he was a Christian, it really turned into a search for truth because I really wanted to know the truth. Here's the problem. How do you have truth without God? Truth is that which conforms to the mind of God. He said, I committed myself to that. I committed to myself that I would place the truth above everything. And later he said that included God, including God. How do you have truth without God? That's what I'd like to defend here. The proof of God is that without God, you cannot know anything at all. And I'd actually like to defend that. I'd like to give you a logical, reasoned approach to this statement right here so that you can understand that. The Bible, I have to skip this, the Bible tells us very clearly that everybody believes in God. It's just that there are some that suppress the truth and unrighteousness. They're holding the truth and unrighteousness. But God is evident to everybody, and that is revealed by their actions. Because everybody here today assumes that truth exists. Even if they deny it with their lips, they're practicing it. You know that you're here. Let me real quickly give you an important concept. if you could be wrong, then you don't really know. For example, if I said the speed limit on the road right outside here is 45 miles an hour, and then I followed that statement with, but I could be wrong. Do I know what the speed limit is out there if I say I could be wrong? No, I don't know what the speed limit is. If I said the Sears Tower is 1,571 feet tall, but I could be wrong. Do I know what the height of the Sears Tower is? No, I do not. Okay, here's my question to you. Out of all the knowledge in the universe, that was my best picture to represent all knowledge. Sorry if that doesn't do it for you. Out of everything there is to know about everything, how much knowledge do you have? Just think to yourself, wives, don't go nudging your husband and tell him nothing yet. We'll get there. It's a minuscule amount, right? Out of everything there is to know about everything. Let me ask you an important question. Suppose you thought you had 1% of all the knowledge in the universe. That would be stretching it, especially for me, I can tell you right now. My wife would agree with that. If you thought you had 1% of all the knowledge in the universe, let me ask you something. Could something out of the 99% of stuff that you don't know contradict the 1% that you think you do know? Could there be something out there that contradicts that 1%?
Yes.
So, you could be wrong about that 1%. That's what you're saying. Well, if you could be wrong, then you don't really even know that 1%. Which means you don't know anything. Because you would have to know everything in order to say that you know something. What's interesting is Mr. Bernie is going to get up and he's going to start making claims about things he says he knows. Here's the problem. You have to know everything in order to know anything at all. Or you have to know someone who knows everything who can reveal truth to you. Ladies and gentlemen, without the one who knows everything, without the God of the Bible, we are forced to say we do not know anything at all. You're forced into the illogical position of claiming that you know that you don't know anything. I did a debate with a guy named Alex last year after the debate. During the debate, he said, I could be wrong about everything. During the debate, he said that, and I said on a Twitter conversation, I said, hey, the truths of God are not a matter of belief or unbelief. They're a matter of acceptance or rejection. I said, yeah, but Alex responded. He said, that's fallacious. I said, yeah, but Alex, you could be wrong. He said, I could be, but so could you, and I'm not. I couldn't help myself. I said, you just contradicted yourself in one tweet, LOL. Now, humanism can be defined this way. The end of all being is the happiness of man. The reason for man's existence is his own happiness. Christianity is the polar opposite. Christianity says the end of all being is the glory of God. Ladies and gentlemen, it is not the brilliant mathematician that has said in his heart there is no God. It's not the scholarly scientist that has said in his heart, there is no God. It's not the amazing atheist that has said in his heart, there is no God. The Bible says, and it's not name-calling here, it's saying intellectually, it is foolish. It is the fool who says in his heart, there is no God. Because without God, you could know nothing at all. There would be no knowledge without God. So, arguing over the evidence, evidence assumes truth. You can't have truth without God.
Thank you. Thank you, Eric. At this point, we're going to give opportunities to both Bernie and Eric to cross-examine and rebut each other's arguments. So Bernie's going to go first. So go ahead.
Okay, so can you let me know, I have 5 minutes for, okay, so 5 minutes for rebuttal, and then 5 minutes I want to do some interchange. Okay, so for rebuttal, he said the fool had said in his heart there is no God. That's what the Bible says, but I'd say the wise man says it out loud.
Is that true?
Yes.
What is truth without God?
Okay, we'll do that in the interactive.
You were asking.
Okay, he says you have to know, this other thing too about you have to have all knowledge or else you don't know anything. I think you can use the same exact argument for Santa Claus, and maybe we can go into that, but I think Santa Claus doesn't exist just like God doesn't exist. They're both the same level. They're both fairy tale creatures. So I think you might say you don't.
Do you want me to challenge that, or you?
Well, we can talk about later. Yeah, but I think you might. I mean, I would hope you say you know for sure that Santa Claus does not exist. I would say I treat God the same way for the same reasons.
You're making a positive claim. You know that God does not exist.
Just the same exact comparison with Santa Claus.
So you know that God does not exist. You have that.
If you know Santa doesn't exist, yeah. Same
okay, so I just want to make sure you're making that claim, because most atheists won't make that claim.
Well, am I sure? I think the evidence shows that God does not exist.
So you're sure that God does not, you're making a positive claim that God does not exist?
I think it's the best reasonable thing is that God does not exist.
So you're not sure. So if I ask you,
I could be wrong, but I'm pretty sure from the evidence I've seen.
Okay, that's very different. That's very different than what you were claiming just a minute.
You know, nobody has 100% knowledge. Nobody knows what's in my pocket. You think there's an elephant in my pocket? Could be. You can't see it. Well, logically, it doesn't make sense. And so I'd say the same logic can be used on the existence of God. Yes, I did. The search for truth. Jesus says, I'm the way, the truth, the life. So I figured, okay, if he's the truth, then the more I search the truth, it's going to lead to Jesus. And if it doesn't, then he basically hung himself. And I have confidence that the truth will lead to Jesus. And that's why I was able to put the truth above God, because I was certain God, there's nothing to worry about. God exists, so the more I search truth, the more I'm going to find God. I searched the truth, and I found God didn't exist. So that's my whole point about putting truth above God. Okay, was that a countdown? Okay. On your website, this is about science. On your website, you say, are atheists forcing Christians to be creationists? There's an article there by Paul Taylor, and it says, I think it has your name as a contributor on that. And it says, the only, this is about a poll. Well, it says, the only comment that I would make on the paragraph is this. It may be hard for a polling organization to understand that science does not proceed by majority vote. Scientific progress almost occurs at the behest of thinkers who are at odds with the preponderance of scientific literature. So basically, it was saying that most scientists accept evolution, but it doesn't matter. It's not a popular vote kind of thing.
Just simply saying majority does not determine truth. We could have the majority of the world believe in Allah, that doesn't mean that that's true.
Okay, do you know what the null hypothesis means?
I do not.
Okay, so a very important thing in science. When you make a hypothesis, it should, and some scientists don't even know this out here, but when you make a hypothesis, it should challenge the existing level of understanding. So, for example, if it's basically the current level of understanding. So in other words, you don't want to say, hey, I just came up with a brand new theory, and that was already explained 100 years ago. If you want to have a new theory, you have to challenge the null hypothesis, which is the current hypothesis. Evolution is the current null hypothesis. And so if you want to have a new hypothesis, what you do is you create it such that it would challenge the null hypothesis. And if it's true, that would become the new null hypothesis. This is scientific consensus, and it's a very important thing in science. So basically there's this idea too that you're putting out there that scientists are wrong and they're challenged all the time by other people. Well, are young Earth creationists changing any science? I mean, they're not, are they publishing any papers? Are they advancing the field in any way at all?
I would say, of course, yeah. There's a list on Answers in Genesis website of over 100 PhD scientists that are doing scientific research right now on young Earth creationism. Yes, that is happening. You can choose to ignore that and continue to make a false straw man argument, but no, that's not true.
Did they make any breakthroughs? Did they discover anything?
Every major field of science was founded by creationists. What do you mean, have they made any breakthroughs? The MRI machine was invented by a creationist. So that, by the way, you're kind of going down a logical fallacy of saying if they don't do any breakthroughs, therefore it's not true. So that's a logical fallacy in itself. But second, yes, there are.
Well, I'm talking about, when I say creationists, I meant actually young Earth creationists who believe that the Earth is only 10,000 or 6,000 years old.
That's exactly what I'm talking about.
How old is the Earth? 6,000 years old?
It's about 6,000 years old.
And there was a global worldwide flood.
4,400 years ago.
44, so about around the 2200 BC, there was a worldwide flood, killed all animals except for those that were saved on Earth.
That's correct.
Is there anybody who, that challenges definitely the null hypothesis in geography and everything. Is there anybody who has done any kind of science to back up that.
Of course, there's tons of science being done. There's a group of scientists right now studying what's called baraminology. Baramin is the kind, the created kind is what it's studying. And so they're actually looking at the animals and saying, hey, we realize that our modern system of classification divides them into species. What were the original kinds of animals that were able to reproduce? The lion and the tiger are both different species, but they're both interfertile. The wolf and the coyote, same
okay,
thing.
Okay, but my point is, though, but the young earth creationists, who are very much minority, they're not changing the null hypothesis at all as far as the age of the earth.
Well, I think there are several documentaries out there that show that they're not going to let it be challenged. There is a consensus that cannot be changed. It was evolutionists themselves that said, the evidence is the fog that fits the landscape. Evolution will never be challenged.
Why can't... Now you're contradicting yourself. You're saying the science cannot be changed, but you said these people
change
science.
No, I'm saying they will not let the evolution worldview be changed.
Well,
that is their starting point. That is their presupposition. So everything they see is from this idea that there is no God and everything evolved. So of course you're going to look at any piece of evidence and conform it to what you believe. When they found soft tissue in dinosaur
okay,
bone...
Okay, but wait a second. Science does change, right? Some people have new hypotheses.
Our understanding can change. The actual laws cannot change. And that's something I'm going to be bringing up. How does an always changing universe, that's what your worldview teaches, invent or come up with an unchanging law of science? Yes, our understanding of gravity may change.
Okay, but here's my point. When you look at the fossil record, there's one total different interpretation from young earth creationists, such as yourself, which is totally at odds with the scientific community, even other Christians. So it's not an atheistic thing. There's older creationists.
That's a logical fallacy. Appeal to majority. That doesn't matter.
Okay,
you said you were in pursuit
of truth,
not majority opinion.
What was the fallacy you said? Appeal to authority?
Yeah.
Okay. Basically,
majority and authority, both of which are logical fallacies.
Okay, well, I think this is an important thing to understand with scientific consensus. I mean, like we talked about chemistry. I mean, neither one of us even have rudimentary understandings of chemistry, and you think you're smarter than the PhDs, who we can't even understand their equations.
I'm not saying I'm smarter at all. By no means am I saying I'm smarter. You got some brilliant guys out there that understand some incredible stuff. But the idea that all those chemicals evolved from nothing, that is ludicrous.
Well, what about the Christians? There's a lot of evangelical Christians that believe that.
It's still a logical fallacy. You're appealing to something. You're not dealing with what truth is.
Well, I'm appealing to the experts, though.
Okay, did you realize that in 1700, from the 1700s to the 1800s, the scientists that knew that they were right about things, from in the 1700s, 100 years later, 90% of what they thought was right was now no longer right. From the 1800s to the 1900s, same exact thing. 90% of what they thought was true was now no longer considered true. So you're saying, well, if the experts say it, I'm going to believe it. Hey, I can get an expert on Star Wars in here. That doesn't prove that all
well,
that really happened.
Star Wars is fiction, so I mean, it's not
exactly.
It's not
evolution is fiction. Evolution is science fiction.
So the problem here is you're not understanding what scientific consensus is, and if you knew what the null hypothesis
appeal,
is, you
would have... It's called to majority. That's a logical fallacy. I'm just simply saying we're in a debate.
Well, I have a friend who could play in a band, and he plays clarinet, I think. I could tell him how to play clarinet. I don't know how to play. My advice is totally worthless to him. If those experts got together and decided how to play it better, they would have something to talk about. How could I tell them that they're wrong or how to do things when it's not even my field?
Okay, so if the majority of scientists believed in young earth creation, you're saying you would believe that. That's your argument right now. That's the argument you're trying to...
Well, number one, I'm not placing my faith in them, but also in the evidence. I've seen the evidence for myself, and it makes sense.
Well, you just said you're not as smart as them, so how can you now say, I've seen all the evidence for myself, and that's how I've come to that conclusion?
Well, part of it was self-study. There's one Christian, Dennis Bienema, he made a YouTube video. He's a Christian, for Christians, about the biological evidence, talking about synteny, pseudogenes, all this stuff about DNA, you can see it in the genome and DNA, you know, evidence for evolution. So, okay, thank you.
Thank you, Bernie. We're going to give Eric Hovind the same opportunity to rebut and cross-examine Mr. Bernie.
All right. What we've seen here is a difference between facts versus opinion. I'm not interested in people's opinion. You've heard it before. Opinions are like armpits. Everybody's got them, and most of them stink, okay? I am not interested in opinion. I am interested in truth. We're supposed to be talking about evidence. Evidence can't be evidence unless it's true. Evidence assumes that truth exists. A fact is a thing that is known to have occurred, to exist, or to be true. That's what facts are. An opinion is a view about a particular issue. In other words, it's what the person believes or thinks and is not necessarily the truth. Just because the majority believes something doesn't make it true. That is not getting down to truth. What we've seen Bernie argue from here is argument ad populum, a logical fallacy. Hey, the majority of scientists believe it. They're really smart. They must be right. Okay, if they're so smart, tell me how come they haven't figured this one out. They say all the chemicals that we have today evolved by fusion in the stars. Problem, the stars are made out of the chemical elements. So which one evolved first? The elements to make the stars or the stars to make the elements? You got a chicken and an egg problem going on here. They're saying, oh, well, the chemicals just evolved from the stars. But the stars are made out of the chemicals. They're made out of the elements. It's a dead end from the word go. Evidence, again, your basis for belief or disbelief. Knowledge on which to base belief. The available body of facts or information indicating whether a belief or proposition is true or valid. We keep coming, when we talk about evidence, we keep coming to these words. Knowledge. Truth. My question to Bernie in just a second, I'll let you think about it, is a couple questions. What is truth without God? You think about that. What is truth without God? How can we have truth without God? Truth is that which conforms to the mind of God. As I've already shown you, without God, we cannot know anything at all. You cannot have knowledge apart from God. With that, I'd like to ask a couple questions to Bernie and allow him to respond. Bernie, could you be wrong about everything you think you know?
Yes.
So you could, you're saying you could be wrong about everything you claim to know.
Yes. Not likely though, but yes, I could be.
Ladies and gentlemen, the debate is now over.
Nope.
Soon as somebody admits...
I'm not done yet.
Soon as somebody admits that they could be wrong about everything, they have just admitted they don't know anything. How difficult is it to debate somebody when they themselves say, I could be wrong about everything, I don't know anything. All right, let's go. You just denied all of knowledge, and now you want to try to debate your knowledge? You just undermined everything that you want to talk about. Okay? If you could be wrong about everything, that means, would you agree, that means you don't actually absolutely know anything to be absolutely true?
I don't know. I haven't thought about the question that much.
If you know something...
I mean, what I'm trying to get over is you actually think you know everything? I mean...
Oh, no, I have not made that claim. Just want to make that clear. I have not said I know...
The scientific mindset is very inquisitive. You have a hypothesis and you test it and you try it and you revise your hypothesis. How do scientists say to know everything? That's what they're running tests for.
What is all that based on? That's based on that there is a truth to discover.
Mm-hmm.
But you just said you could be wrong about everything. Let me ask you this, Mr. Bernie. Does truth exist?
I think so. I mean, are you trying to talk about ontologically exist?
Does truth actually exist?
Well, I would say truth is... let's say, for example, this table. I could say it's about 5 feet. Somebody else could say it's about 100 feet. I would say it's true. It's about 5 feet. I would say it's false. It's 100 feet.
The only way you could make that conclusion is if you knew... what the length of the table was. If I ask you this question, Bernie, which is closer to the truth? 2 plus 2 equals 5 or 2 plus 2 equals 5 million? Which one is closer to the truth?
Yeah, the first one.
Yeah, 5 would be. How do we know that?
From experience.
No, because we know what the truth is. We know the true answer is 4. You cannot have any hypothesis and say, I am searching for the truth if there is no such thing as truth. You're the one who said, I put the search for truth above God, and now you're saying, I'm not sure that truth does exist.
No.
That's inconsistently a problem.
I assume that truth exists. I don't have a problem saying the truth exists. No. I don't have a problem with seeking the truth.
Could you be wrong about that?
I don't know. I'm not sure how that's even important or what that
is. Well, you just said you could be wrong about everything. I'm asking you if you could be wrong about that.
Well, everything is... everything is a hard thing to think about.
Here's what I had said. I said,
I think it should be more specific. Could I be wrong if I say the table's 5 feet? Could I be wrong about that?
Well, I'm talking about everything you claim to know. You name it, I'm asking you, could you be wrong? You earlier said yes, you could be wrong.
Well, I haven't taken that kind of inventory. I mean, if I want to give you a serious answer, I just want to take a serious inventory and look at all the things that I believe and analyze each one.
Then I'll move on to this. What I did claim, I did not claim that I had all knowledge. What I claimed is that in order to say you know anything to be true, you would have to know everything. Otherwise, hang on just a second. Otherwise, you could be wrong, which is what Bernie said. Hey, I could be wrong about everything I claim to know. If you could be wrong, then you don't really have that knowledge. And to say I could be wrong about everything means that I don't know anything at all. I said you'd have to know everything to know anything, or you must know someone who knows everything who can reveal truth to you. The only way we can have knowledge is if the one who knows everything revealed truth to us. That's what we have. The God of Scripture has revealed truth to mankind. Without this, we are forced into the illogical and inconsistent position of saying we could be wrong about everything, therefore we don't know anything. Let me ask you something. Let me just tell you a story here. We've got a little bit of time. I was doing a debate with an atheist online until 2 o'clock in the morning. Anybody ever gotten to experience that? Have you done that before? My wife's like, honey, come to bed. I'm like, hang on, somebody on the internet's wrong. He's going to be there for a while, all right? This atheist that I was debating continued to claim we could be wrong about everything we think we know. Frustrated at 2 o'clock in the morning, finally I said goodnight to him. I went to bed. The next morning I got up to get my daughter ready for school. She was 7 years old. Her name is Stephanie. And I got Stephanie ready for school, and out of frustration, I poured her favorite cereal into the bowl. That wasn't out of frustration, but poured her cereal into the bowl, Honey Bunches of Oats, poured the milk in, put the spoon in, slid the bowl across the bar right there to Stephanie, and I leaned on the counter. And out of frustration, I said, Stephanie, did you know there are some people that say we can't know anything at all? 7 years old. She went, well, how do they know that? The claim, we don't know anything, is a knowledge claim. It would be exactly like me standing here and saying, ladies and gentlemen, I don't believe that words exist. If I made the claim words do not exist, let me ask you something. What would you have to do to prove to me that I'm wrong? Would you run and grab a dictionary and say, uh-huh, see? No, you would say, but you're using words in the exact same way. Bernie is using knowledge. He's looking for evidence. He's looking
questions?
For truth
no.
Without acknowledging where truth can come from. He's denying God and yet assuming God in his search for truth. I'd like to make a couple other points. According to Bernie's arguments, would you agree that is your position that evolution is how we got here? No God. I just want to make sure that's correct.
Yes.
Okay. So is our brain anything more than chemical reactions taking place?
Nope.
That's all that's happening is chemical reactions are taking place.
Right, but I would say,
okay.
Too, don't...
I got 1 minute,
okay.
I want to hurry here.
Okay, but I would say consider the principle of emergence. It's very critical and profound for that.
Okay, I'll let you go into that here in this next part. Here's my position. If our brains are nothing more than chemical reactions going on, let me give you an analogy to show you what that would be like. If I took forget the guy's name who first did this. My apologies for not giving him credit or remembering his name. If I took a bottle of Mountain Dew and a bottle of Dr. Pepper, and I shook them up, and I opened them both, and they fizzed all over this. Doug Wilson, that's his name. And they fizzed all over the place. Here you have a chemical reaction taking place, right? Would it make any sense to call one of those reactions true and one of them false?
No.
No, because they're just simply chemical reactions.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, the chemical reactions in my brain, Bernie, are saying that God exists.
Based on...
Is that true or false?
I think it's false based on evidence.
But you just said that they're chemical reactions. You just said chemical reactions are not true or false, and yet you called mine false. That is inconsistent thinking. Your worldview
well, you're comparing
is
my,
inconsistent.
Well, that's only true if you're comparing my brain to pop.
You're the one who said...
My brain is not pop.
You're the one who said what goes on in our mind... said what goes on in our mind is chemical reactions.
Not the same ones as the pop, though.
Obviously not.
Okay. So
but are chemical reactions true or false?
They're neither one.
They're neither one. Yet you said the ones that are going off in my brain are false. That is inconsistent.
No, my chemical reactions, the way the brain functions, I could analyze true and false.
There is no true and false in chemical reactions.
The chemical reactions evaluate things that are true or false. They give me the ability to evaluate.
You just said that chemical reactions can evaluate something. That is totally illogical.
No, you said the chemical reactions themselves are not true or false. But
those chemical reactions can evaluate something. Have you done a test in the lab, put two chemicals together, and said, okay, hey guys, evaluate that?
It's a totally fallacious example.
You're the one who claimed what's going on in our mind, on our brains, are simply chemical reactions.
But not like pop.
Oh, so they're real special chemical reactions.
Yes, definitely. Of course, neurology.
I'll be more than happy to let you address the crowd with that idea in mind, that our brains are super, super special chemical reactions that can actually evaluate themselves. And I'll let the crowd
address
themselves. Yeah,
it's studied in neurology.
Okay, thank you. We'll move on to the second part of the debate, and that's going to involve morality. So how your worldview is going to affect and influence your beliefs. So we're going to have Bernie start that off. We're going to have Eric start that off. Eric, you're going to start with the morality section.
Thomas. I got to be honest, I did not prepare very much, which the atheists here will be really excited about. They always get mad when we use PowerPoint to try to help make our case. I did not get to prepare a lot because I just found out about this yesterday on the issue of morality. But I would argue the exact same way that I've been arguing. What is good or bad in the evolutionary mindset? See, the evolutionary mindset that says, hey, ladies and gentlemen, we are nothing but chemicals that have gotten together over billions of years and evolved into what we now are today. That worldview can never say what should or ought to be the case. We have what's known as the is-ought problem. What we can say is this is what happened. We can never say this ought to happen. Evolution can never say what ought to be the case. It can only say what is the case. Again, I go back to my analogy with mathematics. How do we know that 2 plus 2 equaling 5 is closer than 2 plus 2 equals 5 billion? Because we know the true answer. The true answer is 4. Without knowing the truth, you cannot in any way know what is a better answer. In the same way, when it comes to morality, if we do not know what is morally, what's the word, justified? If we don't know what is moral, what morality is, we can never, ever, ever say that something is better than another. I would argue, and I don't mean to put words in your mouth and you can correct me if I'm wrong, I would assume that Bernie would think that helping an old lady across the street is better than molesting a child for fun. I'm going to assume that. Here's the problem. You can't know what is better if you don't know what the best is. If you don't know what correct morality is, you can never say that this is better than that. I'm sure, and this is just based on my experience with atheists, he'll probably argue something like this, and please correct me if I'm wrong when I'm done here, okay? This is just what I typically heard. Well, good, moral, is that which helps society. Or good is that which does the least amount of harm to people. Here's the problem. If I ask the question, why is it wrong to harm people? The only answer we could give is an opinion. Well, I think it's wrong to harm people. We can never appeal to an absolute morality in that worldview. Here's another interesting thing. The laws that govern morality. Let me ask you something. Well, I guess I can't really ask you something because that would get crazy here. But think to yourself, are moral laws, are they absolute?
No.
If we say that, remember you're supposed to answer inside, Mike. If we say, no, they are not absolute, then let me ask you something. Is it possible that at some time in some country, molesting children for fun will be right? That will be the right thing to do. I don't see very many people shaking their head. Yep, it'll be the one day that could be the right thing to do. No. Why? Because you're appealing to an absolute morality. So we find out that the laws of morality are unchanging. They don't change. I mean, let me ask you something. Will there ever be a time in history when the laws of morality change? I mean, I'm not talking about our understanding, by the way. I'm talking about the actual laws. Our understanding may change, but the actual laws themselves. And let's use an extreme example just for this illustration. Will there ever be a time when we can say, hey, one day, molesting children for fun will be the right thing to do? No. Why? Because the moral laws that govern us are unchanging. Here's another interesting thing. Moral laws are not made out of matter, are they? I mean, I can write down what my moral code is. I can codify the moral law. But this is not the actual moral law. This is a representation of the moral law. I don't know if that makes sense to you. But the laws of morality are not material in nature. You can't go down to the hardware store and buy a law of morality, put it in a jar, paint it red. You can't do that, okay? They're immaterial. The laws of morality are immaterial. They are unchanging. And one more thing, guys. They are universal. They apply everywhere. In other words, now what you're talking about, some of you are shaking your head, no, they're not. What we're talking about is cultural relativism. We're not talking about absolute moral laws. In other words, could we say that, you know what, in another country, molesting for children for fun is the right thing to do over there. That is morally right. Are there cultures that practice some things that we would disagree with today? Absolutely. Does that make them morally correct or right? No, it does not. If it did, then you could never have a cultural revolution. If that was correct and society governed morality, then Martin Luther King should have kept his mouth shut. We should still have African Americans as slaves today if cultural relativity was true. We should not be going to another culture and saying, here's what's right and here's what's wrong and you're doing it wrong and we want you to fix it. Because it's all culturally relative. If that is the case, we have no business going to another culture and saying what you're doing is wrong. We should not have bothered Adolf Hitler. He was doing fine according to his cultural morality. The truth is, every single one of us knows moral laws are universal, they are immaterial, and they are unchanging. They don't change from time to time. Absolute moral laws do not change. Don't confuse that. I'm not talking about our understanding. I'm talking about the actual laws of morality. Here's my question. How does the strictly material world that Bernie described himself as a naturalist, how does the strictly material world come up with an immaterial law? How does matter come up with something that is not made out of matter? How does a universe that, according to Bernie's worldview, is always changing, it's always evolving, how does it come up with unchanging laws of morality? Laws that do not change. They're constant. How does unchanging, universal? Anyway, I forget which one I was on there. But there's 3 points. These laws are universal, immaterial, and unchanging. The secular worldview, the humanist worldview that Bernie believes in, and atheism, says that things are always changing. Says that they're always changing. They're not universal, and everything's made out of matter. That worldview cannot account for universal, immaterial, unchanging laws of morality. By the way, it's the same with laws of logic, laws of science, and laws of mathematics. The strictly material world could never come up with laws of logic, science, math, and morality that are universal, immaterial, and unchanging. You know what can? A universal, immaterial, unchanging God. That's what can account for the way that we live our lives right here. I did a debate in California. I got a little bit of time. I did a debate in California against a guy that actually just Skyped me or Facebooked me the other day. It's been a couple years. He dressed up like a pirate, looked kind of funny, and wanted to do this debate. It was interesting. I'm very thankful that this is much more of a debate. During the debate, they continued to say, no, there are no moral laws. So, you know, there's no absolute moral laws. Afterwards, I was arguing with a kid that was making that claim. There are no moral absolutes. He was holding a box of cookies. I grabbed his box of cookies and I said, give me your cookies. Guess what he said, the nerve of it. He said, no. I said, give me your cookies. He said, no. Thankfully, I was bigger than him. If it was like a big girl, wouldn't have done that. But I was bigger than him. I said, give me your cookies. He said, no. I said, if there were no moral absolutes, I could beat you up and take them away if I wanted, and I would be justified. It would be okay for me to do that. Without absolute moral laws, you can never say what ought to be the case. You can only say what is the case. Morality inherently tries to say, here's what ought to be the case. Without God, you got a serious is-ought problem. What you can say is, this is the case. Here is what happened. You can't ever say, here's what ought to happen. So in this debate so far, I think we've seen that evidence assumes truth. Truth assumes God. So as we debate over evidence, we have to assume God in order to do that. Here in the issue of morality. Morality assumes an ought, assumes what should be the case. You cannot have that without an absolute lawgiver, the God of the Bible.
Thank you, Eric. And we're going to give the same opportunity to Bernie.
If you're right, I give up.
Woo! Are you sure about that?
Yeah.
Could you be wrong?
Yeah. Okay, I think one of the best articles on, my mentor, I would say, on this morality topic is Steven Pinker, and I had a reference here. He wrote for the New York Times about morality. I think there are three basic ways to classify moral philosophies, and there are probably many more. If you study philosophy, there's a bunch of moral philosophies, but I think there's a way, maybe three groupings. One is divine command theory, one is based on feelings, and one is based on reason. So divine command theory basically is, basically God said it, that's all there is to it. You don't think. It says in the Bible, this is it, that's what we do. There's no thinking required. The problem with this is that there's horrible ancient morals described in the Bible, such as exterminating peoples to get their land, killing a woman if she's found not to be a virgin on her wedding night, as if you could even tell if she, you know, if there's a way to even tell for sure. And then, you know, condoning slavery. You know, and if Eric thinks he follows the laws of God, well, the Jews have 613 and thousands more derived from those, but as a young earth creationist, I don't think he even obeys the Sabbath, number four, according to what the Bible says. In Exodus 31, I'll read to you. Then the Lord said to Moses, say to the Israelites, you must observe my Sabbath. This will be a sign between me and the generations to come, so you may know that I am Lord, who makes you holy. Observe the Sabbath, because it is holy to you. Anyone who desecrates it is to be put to death. Those who do any work on that day must be cut off from their people. So he says they must be put to death if they don't follow the Sabbath. Does that sound very moral to you? And he also says it will be a sign between me and the Israelites forever. Well, Eric, how come you don't follow the Sabbath as outlined in the Old Testament? Something to think about. So that was the first way. Well, God said it. I don't think about it. That's just the way it is. That's morals. Another way is just a lot of people, and maybe even atheists, go by this other way of just feelings, what feels right. I don't know what's right, but I mean, I can't really explain it, but it just feels right. I think a lot of that is based on reciprocity, like the golden rule. Jesus said to treat others as you want to be treated. Before him, Confucius said it 500 years earlier. Why is that? Well, because it works. It has very nice consequences. So the third way, which I would advocate, is using moral reasoning. So first off, we start off with, what is good and bad? What does that mean? Well, good simply leads to flourishing, and bad leads to pain. Eric said, well, how do you explain this is-ought thing? So in moral philosophy, the question is, you'd say, it's bad to rape somebody, but why ought you not rape somebody? Or it's bad not to feed a starving person, but why ought you feed somebody? There's no way to get from an is or an ought. But actually there is. If you understand that morality is all about moral reasoning, the ought is what you should do if you want to be a good person. And what's a good person? A person that does things that leads to flourishing and minimizes pain. So it's actually really quite simple. I don't see why it's so complicated for people like Eric.
So why is it wrong? Oh, and then, so he says, why, okay, so for example, you might say, if it leads to pain and suffering, that's bad. But why is that bad? That's just your opinion? Well, why isn't it obvious why pain is bad? Because it hurts. It should be avoided at all costs. Who, you know, isn't that just obvious? We should minimize pain and maximize good feelings. And that's how things would flourish. To explain why is it good to feel good? Why is it bad to feel bad? I just don't understand why you're asking those kind of questions. So anyway, here's a rubric I could offer for moral reasoning. Basically, you can put any kind of moral question through three pillars. One is consequentialism, which means you analyze perceived outcomes. One is reciprocity, which means you want to treat others like you want to be treated. And the other one is individual freedom. So, and then you should also see these from a third-person planetary view rather than from a tribal view or from your personal viewpoint. So let me give you an example. Rape. Well, he would say rape is just obvious. There's absolute morals, because who can argue with that? Well, when you put it through this rubric, well, it's kind of obvious too, because, you know, if you don't want to be raped, so you shouldn't rape other people. Consequentialism. What would the world be like if everybody was raping everybody? you know, personal freedom too. I mean, that's another one to consider. So that's on one extreme. It's obvious because it's such an easy violator of all these principles. On the other one, the other extreme would be like feeding a starving person. Why would you want to feed a starving person? Why should you do that? Well, for reciprocity. If you were starving, you would want somebody to feed you. So this is why we have empathy for other people, because we can put ourselves in their place. We know what it feels like to be hungry, so we can actually minimize our own pain by helping them out. So now there's some difficult moral questions that take more reasoning, because sometimes they conflict. So for example, if you're the president of the United States and they say there's a bunch of Muslim extremists who hijacked an airplane and it's headed for the White House, what do you want to do? They already know what they're going to do. They're going to scramble jets and they're going to shoot it down. There's no thinking about it. But if you're a Christian, I've asked Christians this and they struggle with it. Well, I don't know if you should shoot it down. Maybe we should pray. Maybe we should wait and see what happens. But, you know, using this kind of reasoning, it's like, hey, we already know what's going to happen. We already figured it out. You're going to shoot them down to minimize danger and loss and deprive them of a victory. And then there's all kinds of signs that morality has emerged. Franz de Waal is a guy who wrote a book called Primates and Philosophers, How Morality Evolved. He gives numerous examples by looking at animals in the wild. For example, chimps and bonobos. I read something that I know is a favorite topic of yours. You wrote a little bit about that, with morality. So that's it. So let me talk about, a question he had. The moral law. Well, who makes morals? I mean, they're just floating out there. How can a material world make morals? William Lane Craig also talks about that too. Like, he thinks is these moral laws, they have what they call an ontological existence, as if they exist out there. Well, to me, I think it's the same thing as numbers. You know, where do numbers exist out there? And I saw Eric had a video about that. He thinks they do exist out there, ontological. And I heard William Lane Craig say, well, I don't know about that. The philosophers debate that, and I don't really have a position. The equations, who makes all the equations? Do they exist ontologically, or are they things we discover? So these are just philosophical questions, but I think Eric's trying to jump to this God of the Gaps thing of saying, hey, we can't comprehend this, therefore it's all in God. So let me just say in summary, since I have some time here, I want to drag this home that good and bad has nothing to do with God. What's good is good for a person, and see it from a planetary worldview. So it's not, in other words, it's like, hey, you know what, if I stole $1 million from that guy, that'd be really good for me. That's a good thing. No, you didn't see it from a third-party perspective. Well, maybe it'd be good, you know, like, that's a good question about, he says, if he's strong, would he be... would it be right for him to take something by power? Well, you know, I was thinking, it sounds like the American Indians. What did we do to the Native Americans? We took their land, and we never hear anybody repenting of that or anything. It's like, wow, that's, you know, we're great America, and we don't ever talk about that. So, I think I'll leave it with that.
Okay.
This time we're going to have the same format, so Eric's going to go ahead and rebut and cross-examine Bernie's perspective on morality.
First question, Mr. Bernie, could you be wrong about everything that you just said?
I'm just telling you how I understand things.
Right, my question is simple. Could you be wrong about everything that you just said?
It just seems to me like you're a word game. I don't understand what you're trying to get at.
Could you be wrong about everything that you just said in your last 10 minutes?
Well, I suppose. Maybe an alien came from outer space and they had another million years of evolution and they came by and said, yeah, you know, you guys are primitive. That's the stage you're at. Let me show you how it really goes. Maybe it's more refined. Yeah.
To say that, yes, I could be wrong about everything I just said undermines everything he just said. To say that, hey, let's give it, well, I could be wrong. Yeah, it could have been an alien that came. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm not trying to engage in name calling. And I hope you don't misunderstand my confidence or my zeal for bullying. That's certainly not what I want to do. But the Bible says it is the fool that has said in his heart there is no God. To say, yes, I could be wrong about everything I just said. Hurting people could be the good thing instead of the bad thing. Helping people could be the bad thing instead of being the good thing. Undermines everything that was just said. A bunch of knowledge claims were just made, and then they were undermined by the statement, but I could be wrong about absolutely everything. That, by the way, is why these debates don't go very far. Soon as you admit, I could be wrong about everything, you said you don't know anything. And that undermines everything that was just said. I do have a couple questions, though, for you as we continue
say,
on.
I would just say one thing there. I don't understand your points. I don't even know how to respond to it.
You know what? I agree with that. I can even tell you why. Now, you're not going to like my answer, but here's why. The Bible actually says that spiritual things are not understood by the natural man. Until God grants repentance, we will not see the truth. There's a great verse in 2 Timothy verse 2, chapter 2, verse number 25 that says, if God peradventure will grant them repentance to the acknowledging of the truth, until God grants repentance, you cannot see the truth. So I can understand you saying, I don't understand where you're coming from here. You cannot see where I'm coming from.
Well, I was once a Christian just as much as you are, and if you want to, we can get a challenge to see who was the bigger Christian, and we can make, let's see who could outdo each other. What did you do? What did I do? What did you do?
I already said at the beginning, what you're saying I used to be a Christian is assuming that God does exist. What you should say is, I used to be delusional. That would be consistent with where you're at now. It's impossible, you can make the statement, but it cannot be true that you used to be a Christian. 1 John chapter 2 even tells us, those that left us were never among us. Those that left us were actually never among us. So you cannot say, I used to be a Christian. As a Christian, Christ is the head of my reasoning. You cannot go from a position where Christ is the head of your reasoning to you being the head of your reasoning. If you are now the head of your reasoning, then Christ never was the head of your reasoning. Like I said, these things are not going to make sense to the unbeliever. I get that. I understand that. A dead man coming back to life will not make sense if you say God does not exist. The earth being 6,000 years old, that does not make sense if you don't believe in the supernatural doing that. So we don't see any evidence of miracles in the natural world. The whole idea of a miracle is that there is no evidence, okay? That's the whole point of it. So we're missing that. He said we need to see it from a global worldview. Taking the $1 million from that guy might be good for me, but it's bad from the global worldview. Why? We have not answered. Like I said, we're going to have an is-ought problem. We can say what is the case. We can't say that ought to be bad. You can tell, and I'm sorry, I don't know how much you've thought about this, but you kept kind of going, well, we really don't even have to give a why. You know, don't we just all know that? You know what the truth is? Yes, hurting people is bad, but that's based on my worldview with a God that says, here is my character. Why is lying wrong? Not because God just arbitrarily decided, you know what, I'm going to make lying wrong. It's because God is not a liar. Why is adultery wrong? It's not because God made an arbitrary decision and said, well, you know what, it's probably going to hurt families. People are probably going to get hurt feelings from it. So It's because God is perfectly faithful. That's why adultery is wrong. I mean, I was challenged by some atheists one time when they said, let me ask you something, Eric. Would you behave differently if you didn't believe in God? I said, absolutely. I mean, you'd have to make sure the jail cell could hold me because I'd be trying to break out, man. I would do anything under the sun if I truly believed that there was no God and there were no moral absolutes. Good leads to flourishing, bad leads to pain. Says who? Who makes that decision? If you can't give me a who, that's your opinion. You haven't given me truth, which is what you said you were in the pursuit of. That's my problem. Was that 10 or 5?
That's fine.
That's fine.
Yeah, we're done.
Okay.
And these rebuttals and cross-examinations are 5 minutes. And at this point, we're going to have Bernie cross-examine Eric's stance.
Okay, Eric, can we judge a person's actions to see if they're immoral or not, even if they're the president, the king, or a dictator?
Can we judge a human being's action? Yes, we can.
Okay. Are you sure about that? 100% sure.
I judge other people's morality. Okay. Yes, I do.
So can we judge God's behavior also, as written in the Old Testament?
My question would be, by what standard are you judging it by?
Same standard you judge people by.
I judge by God's standards. So to judge God by God's standards, it'd be inconsistent to say, hey, I'm going to use God's standard to then come back and say, God, you're wrong.
Well, for example, if a guy raped a woman, you would say that's immoral. But if God raped a woman, would that be immoral?
Well, God can't do that, and he wouldn't do that. And yes, that would be immoral.
Okay, so now you can judge God.
That would be immoral. Raping a woman is an immoral act.
Okay, so you can judge God if he were to do that. You don't think he would do it, but if he were to do that, then you could judge God.
Okay.
Right? Okay, good, because that's a point. So now we got established here, we can judge God. So now we just look at what this Yahweh character in the Old Testament do. So in Deuteronomy 22, it talks about it. If you find a girl who's supposedly not a virgin, like I said, I mean, you can't even tell if a woman for sure whether she's a virgin or not. But if she's not a virgin...
I could, by the way, and mine was.
There we go. Okay. If your wife had a...
Of course.
If the hymen was broken, that does not mean that... number one, they could have sex. Some hymens are flexible, so they could have sex even after penetration and not broken. I know, but we're talking about the Bible, too.
I agree. I don't talk about a lot of things that the Bible talks about.
And the other thing is, the hymen could be broken for reasons beyond sex, just exercising or accidents. So it doesn't prove anything. And now God says, hey, if you think your woman is guilty of this, you can kill her.
Is that wrong?
Of course.
On what standard? Who are you? Is that your opinion, or are you applying to a standard?
On consequentialism, on reciprocity.
Could you be wrong about that?
And not only that, but there's no evidence for it.
Could you be wrong about the fact that that is wrong of God?
I don't think so. I mean, that's like saying you'd be wrong. I mean, no, I think it's not...
absolutely true.
To kill, even if she was guilty of being not a virgin on a wedding night, I think it's immoral to say kill her. Is that one of your unchanging...
Based on whose standard? All I'm asking, you've got to give me the who says so.
Okay.
You know, when I'm talking with my son and I say, clean your room, he's like, I don't want to. And I say, buddy, clean your room. And he goes, why? And I say, because I said so.
Okay, so
I'm applying to a standard.
So do you think that's a good moral law that God laid down in Deuteronomy?
I'm not about to... First of all, we are in a totally different time. You confuse several things by
yourself in that time.
By reading something from the text that said this applied to Israel, why doesn't Eric do this?
Thought
I'm
experiment.
Not in Israel. I'm
thought
not
experiment.
Jew.
Go back in the time, that culture, that everything. Is that a moral thing? You said morals don't change
for example,
culture and time.
One of the things that I'm sure... I don't know. Maybe you already knew this. Maybe you didn't. But it's actually the reason when a woman was raped in the Bible... The man who raped her was actually required to marry her is because she couldn't get married back then if that had been the case. He was required to marry her to take care of her because otherwise nobody would take care of her. It was actually morally...
That's a different question.
It was a morally good thing for that to happen.
That's a different question. I'm talking about killing a woman.
Who?
Killing a woman.
I'll tell you this, anything that God commands is moral. When God, let's take it to an extreme. What about killing the entire population of the world except for eight people?
My turn to ask questions.
Was that morally right or wrong?
I just wanted to see if we established that. You said, I think you can judge the actions of God, the character in the Bible.
Anything that God commands is moral.
And so you think this is a moral command?
If you say it's not, my question is, says who?
I'm asking your opinion. You think it's a moral command. It's
I
a
think
good
that
thing.
What God does is moral. Morality comes from God's very character.
So you think that was a good moral thing to do, is to kill a woman who's accused of being not a virgin?
Let me answer this. Is it right for a man to stab a little girl in the chest with a knife?
What does that have to do with the Old Testament passage?
It's going to make perfect sense after you answer the question. Is it right or wrong for a man to stab a little girl in the chest with a knife?
Maybe in self-defense, if there was a different situation.
let's make a side rule. Is it right for a man to stab a five-year-old in the chest with a knife?
What if the guy was droggy, he was asleep, he woke up and she had a gun to his head, and so he did in self-defense?
It's more relative.
I mean, it's situational.
Okay, so if it was let's make it real easy. The little girl was lying there asleep. Is it right for a man to stab a little girl in the chest with a knife?
No.
It's not.
No, it's not.
What if I gave you a little more information? Here's exactly what happens when we talk about the Old Testament. What if I gave you a little more information? What if the little girl's under anesthetic? And it's a world-class surgeon that's going to do heart surgery, and if he doesn't do that, she's going to die.
So like I said, it depends on the situation.
But what you said at first is, it's not morally right to apply to an absolute standard until you got some more information.
Right.
Then you said, yes, that is morally correct. That's the exact same way with
the
Old Testament. You and I don't understand all the things that God was doing back
then.
It's
not hard to understand about the situation if she's accused of being a virgin and she
You know what?
Doesn't
those are things that are absolutely fabulous questions for a Bible study. But for somebody who denies knowledge, those questions don't even make sense.
Well, there's a lot of people that study moral philosophy, so they think it makes sense.
And if they deny knowledge, it doesn't make sense, does it? Can you deny knowledge and then say anything you study actually makes sense? No.
Do you think, for example, if you're the president of the United States, let's say, for example, how much time do I have left? Okay. Let's say, for example, Muslim extremists hijack an airplane and send to the White House. If you're the president, would you give the order to shoot it down?
I'll answer the question. I'll back it up. I'll start it off with this. I find it interesting that you are somebody who would agree with cultural relativism, but you would call what they're doing wrong. They believe it's right. What right do we have to stop them? And now this isn't my worldview. This would be consistent with your worldview. What right do you have to stop them from doing what they believe is actually right?
Well, I'm going to find out your answer. Would you give the order to shoot down with your moral understanding?
For all the Muslims out here,
I don't care if it's a Muslim or a Christian.
I hope that we all repent and trust in Christ.
I don't care who they are. If they're any kind of hijackers with an airliner hijacked and sent to the White House, would you give the order to shoot down? There's 300 people on board.
In a way, what I would do is irrelevant to your act, because what you're asking for is my opinion.
I'm looking for your moral reasoning to see how you calculate things.
But if you can't know what truth is, how can you even be looking for what my moral reasoning is if you don't know what is moral?
So the problem is the Bible doesn't say, so you don't know.
Oh, no, I know what I would say. My point is, you're trying to judge me based on an absolute moral standard that you say you don't even have.
Well, I'm trying to figure out what your moral reasoning is, and you don't seem to have an answer for it. For me, it's easy.
The Bible tells us very clearly there are times for justified war. Yes, it is justifiable to stop an attack on you. That is justified war, according to the Scripture. Yes.
Okay, and that's good. Thank you. I'm going to be passing out. They're going to have closing statements a little bit later, but we're going to have questions and answers. If you guys, we're going to have the open mic. We're going to do it without the mic. It's going to crowd the hallway. But anyways, I'm just going to split these in two. And if you guys can pass that down.
What are the cards for?
Questions. If you guys have questions, and they will be sent up. And then in a minute, we're going to be... you guys will be able to ask one question, and that's it. So one question, and then verbally, without the mic, and then you can address it to whomever, and then they will answer So at this point, I guess, we can just go ahead and start with a question. Go ahead, back there, in white, in white.
Our scientific definition of life is a self-replicating system that can evolve. So if you don't believe in evolution, I'd like to hear what your definition of life is.
Now, the Bible says... The Bible describes life nephesh. It says the life of the flesh is in the blood. Like, example, the biblical word for life probably wouldn't include trees because they don't have blood in them. It says they have the breath of life and they have blood. So if our modern science today says life is a complicated, you know, system that reproduces, okay, that's our definition today. I would go according to God's definition and say life is... the life of the flesh is in the blood. So I would classify trees and plants, for example, as a very complicated, self-replicating food source. I don't know if biblically I can term them alive, but that gets into the whole other debate of you know, what is a kind versus a species and things like that. It's just, you know, the Bible would classify a whale as a fish. You made all the fish of the sea and the birds of the air on day number five of creation. And our modern classification doesn't classify it the same way.
Next question for Bernie.
Okay, yeah, and we'll follow with the next question for Bernie interchangeably. So, but before we do that, I was going to interrupt. I'm pretty sure most people are going to stick around for these Q&As. However, since some people are leaving, I just wanted to announce that there's going to be more of these sessions at Clark College. And tomorrow night at Clark College, for those of you interested in Vancouver, six p.m. tomorrow, Clark College, and then there's an additional event in Battleground. There should be flyers for those people looking. Also, can you describe your ministry? And just in a few words, just to interject right here. And we also wanted to raise some money because you flew in here and you're doing all this for us. So we want to go ahead and
nothing,
raise some money.
Nothing for Bernie?
Bernie?
Our ministry creation today exists to strengthen the faith of believers and win the lost to Christ. That's what we're all about. And so we go around talking about the evidence, the proof of God, creation versus evolution. And I love to share my testimony on Saturday night at a Ukrainian church here in town. I'll be sharing my testimony. Mine is the exact opposite of Bernie's. I went on a quest, a journey to know God, and man, he revealed himself to me in a powerful way, and I went, oh my goodness, I got to share this with others. So our ministry is based out of Pensacola, Florida. You can find us online at creationtoday.org, and we've got articles, videos, tons of free stuff out there. We thought about copywriting our DVDs, but we knew the Russians out there would copy them anyway, so it's just not copyrighted. Go ahead and copy them. So it's a non-profit 501c3 ministry, and if you want to make a donation, it is tax deductible. I wasn't expecting that, but very kind.
Okay, so the next question is for Bernie. May I see your hands? Yes, please.
I got a question for Bernie. So it's just an example, just figure out how this works. Okay, my question for you, just an example. So you walk in the street, I mean somewhere in a wild place, just the wild. So then you can see the stone.
See what?
Stone. Mm-hmm. Just the stone.
Right.
And what do you think? It's a proud look. Product by the man or product by just the wild thing? What do you think?
Nature.
Natural. Okay, good. Then you just say, oh, probably the human never been in here, right? So you just pass this stone, just the walk and farther, then you find out, for example, watch. Okay? So what do you think? It's natural or it's has a creation for that?
It's natural but designed by humans.
Designed by humans. Yeah, I mean, yeah, that is the mechanism. I mean, somebody has to assemble it to make this watch work, right? So if just one little gear, it's not going to be a profit, it's not going to work ever, right? So, which means, I mean, we're talking from the Bible side, you're talking from the other side, and we're going to figure out who is this right. Okay, now I'd like to ask you the last thing. And don't you think every complicated mechanism has creator? Every single complicated mechanism has creator. And thinking about the eyes.
Yeah, I think this goes back to what I said earlier about Richard Dawkins had a really good TED talk on what he called medium world. We evolved in medium world, so we understand medium world, and we don't really understand things in a small world, like at the micron or submicron level or the nuclear level, because we don't know what it's like to experience things like that, and we don't know what it's like to experience the big things. And so, you know, just like I said, ancient man thought God caused the earthquake because somebody, you know, elephants make stampede, you know, they stampede, then you feel the earth shake, and it's even bigger. Obviously, somebody did it. Well, nobody did it. It was a plate tectonics. So.
Okay, and the next question is going to be for Eric. Go ahead.
Why is it that men in the Christian faith demand virginity, and why isn't it that women, or maybe I should ask, do women demand that as well?
Her question having to do with morality is, why is it that Christian men demand virginity, and yet the Christian women, I'm assuming, cannot demand that of men?
Do women demand that in general in the Christian faith?
I would define the Christian faith and say, as a Christian, of course I want my wife to be pure. I've kept myself pure. I want her to be pure. I'm so glad that in my marriage, that's exactly what has happened. I praise God for that. I'm thankful for that. I don't think I can speak on behalf of all men and say that all men demand that. I know that for me, yeah, that was something important. That represented a faithful trust that God knows what's better for me even than I do. I can think that it's good and moral and okay. God says, you know what? I know what's better for you than you do. And statistically, I think it'd be very easy to back that up and show, look, bottom line is, that is, it's statistically, emotionally, relationally, it's a better thing.
However, let's say you fell in love with somebody, not pinpointing your wife exactly, and found out that after you've fallen in love with her and everything, you realize that she was previously either raped or had a sexual partner in the past. Would you still consider that marriage, or would you just automatically throw that love that you have for her?
The Bible actually has a great passage that talks about this. It's the book of Hosea, where God actually commands one of his prophets to go and buy a prostitute and marry her. They're married. She ends up leaving him. He goes back and he buys her at the auction again, saying, I love you so much. So, and that was an example of exactly what Christ has done for us. Ladies and gentlemen, you and I are unclean before God. We are, if you can put it in that vernacular, we're not virgins before God. Now, God's blood and forgiveness wants to cover that for you. So if it was me personally, I guess first of all, I can't even put myself in that hypothetical situation because it didn't happen. So I don't know what I would do because that didn't happen to me. But can Christ's blood forgive sin? Absolutely it can.
What if you were not a virgin? Would you still have wanted?
We're still in this hypothetical, and I don't know the answer to that. Here's what I do know. I know that I am supposed to love the way Christ loved. I now forgive people the way Christ has forgiven me.
But you still judge them.
I don't. Yeah, but I forgive them. I love them. If I judge, I do so according to the same standard that I'm judging myself. That's what the Bible commands us to do. It says, if you're going to judge, don't judge somebody else by a different standard than you judge yourself. Judge by the exact same standard. And that's where the whole beam in the eye comes from. So those would be my answers.
Check that one. Just a little correction. Questions, one question at a time. If you have a question followed up by a question, if it's one of those questions, just come up with a different question. That would be best, because we're very constrained on time. This is a question for Bernie. Go ahead.
My question for Bernie Bernie is. I'm not going on the S1.
Yeah.
Well, I have my degree. I'll go to the hardest one. How did the recent issue of Scientific American on the newsstand says that the human brain is the most complicated machine on Earth? And I want to know how a self-replicating, most complicated machine on Earth by the atheist Scientific American, how did that come to be?
Okay, well, that's a good... Okay, so the question is, Scientific American said the brain is the most complicated machine on Earth. How did that come to be as an atheist? To follow up what I say to the previous question to me, I want to acknowledge that when you look at, like, for example, the cell structure and what's going on in the cell, it is mind-boggling. I mean, when you look at it, it takes your breath away. That's for sure. And again, this goes so much to how you need to watch this Richard Dawkins video on TED, because it... We just don't understand it from our perspective being involved in this middle world. Now, as far as the brain, I used to think, too, maybe the brain was the most advanced machine in the world, but I'm not so sure anymore, especially with computer intelligence. I mean, I work at a computer company. We make the fastest chips in the world, and they wear these bunny suits. And these supercomputers, they can outperform humans doing certain things. For example, you cannot compete at all doing calculations with a supercomputer. So in some way, the brain is really amazing, but it may be soon surpassed, maybe 1,000 years from now, 10,000, a million years from now. These computer intelligences are going to outdo the brain. It's because of evolution. We're going into mimetic evolution, which is the evolution of ideas, and not just in creating robots, but robots are going to be creating other robots. You know, so it's just information.
Oh, with intelligent design, though.
Well, intelligent design is a totally different thing. I mean, what do you mean by that? See, just a word about intelligent design. There's an old school intelligent design which a lot of Christians believe in. It's in Psalms. The heavens declare the work of God. That's one kind of intelligent design. There's another kind of intelligent design that's very popular from the Discovery Institute, which says, you know, these have these cells and they have to be created this way, otherwise they don't work, like the mousetrap idea. That's something a lot of academics who are evangelicals are dismissing because it's unscientific. So when you say intelligent design, I think it's good to clarify which one you're talking about.
Self-replicating also.
Okay, go ahead. You have your hand raised.
So, Eric, I just want to ask you a quick question. How do you justify in your morality 1 Timothy 2, chapter 2, verse 13 through 15? That says that women are only saved through childbearing. That they are only saved through childbearing.
Look up. Give me the reference, 1 Timothy.
1 Timothy 2:13 through
2:15. I'm going to say it because there are people listening.
Yeah.
Can't hear.
Go ahead.
So how do you justify the text, 1 Timothy?
2:13 through 2:15.
Through 2:15.
I can read it. So, it says, for Adam was first formed, then Eve. Adam was not deceived, but the woman being deceived has fallen into disobedience. But she will be saved through her childbearing if they continue in faith, love, satisfaction, and sobriety. What that is saying is she is saved through childbearing. How is it moral to send a barren woman to hell?
My answer would be a couple things. First of all, that is a great question for a Bible study. Somebody who denies knowledge, it's kind of silly to talk about what is true.
No, this is morality. We're talking morality.
No, I understand. Let me answer here. It would be really foolish to give a reasoned, truthful answer to somebody that denies truth.
Oh, I can't understand what you're saying?
No. Max, it's my turn now. You did your question.
Okay.
I'm getting to that, which is kind of interesting because, you know, Christians in here or believers in here that are asking Bernie questions, I need to remind you. You're asking questions to a man that has denied knowledge. And yet he's going to stand here and make knowledge claims to you? It doesn't matter what you ask him. He's already denied knowledge. Could you be wrong about the fact that you work in a computer place that makes computer chips? Could you be wrong about that? That is the issue.
Does a Muslim, does a Hindu, does a Jew?
You're going to get me kicked out if you keep going.
Does it defy knowledge?
You're not allowed to blurt out like that. It's one of the rules.
Answer my question.
Written on the outside. So this is a great question for a Bible study. My thing though is you have a very you have a misunderstanding, a misconception of what it's saying here by the word "save." That's not the word salvation as in what is necessary for salvation, repentance, and trust in Jesus Christ as a Savior. So your question is actually flawed from the get-go. You're assuming that means salvation to go to heaven versus going to hell, and that's your problem there. But great question for a Bible study, really good one to go to. But first of all, I would challenge, do we actually know anything?
Why does it clarify? Why does it clarify continue in faith?
I would challenge, if we don't know anything, then it does no good to even talk about it. It's interesting to me that that happens. We're asking questions that assume truth and assume knowledge, and from the atheist worldview, there is no such thing.
Okay, we're going to take a question for Bernie, and I have a person here.
Hey, my question is more of a statement, you know, when it comes from the Word of God above, and this is what it said. It says, if our gospel, which we preach, is hidden, it is hidden to those that are perishing. So understand this. Even if we speak with facts and everything that, you know, might get to you, but if God don't reveal it to you, who the God of this world is blinded, you're going to hell. So you got to understand, homie, it ain't about this man or what he seeks, because all this is going to perish. From dust to king, dust we go. That's it. But my question for you, man, what do you think about that?
I've been there, done that. Eric said, oh, you were never a true Christian. I was like, well, you're not a true Christian either. What do you want to do, have a competition? This seems the real Christian here. What are you talking about? Yeah, the Bible says that you cannot turn away if you're a true believer. That's because the Bible's wrong. I'm sorry. And you know what? When you get to know atheists, you'll see there's a whole bunch of former Christians in atheism. But if you don't know atheists, it's easy to say, oh, the Bible says that, so that's the way it is. I just want to make one comment here about the passage you brought up. As a Christian, that's a trouble passage. Because it could either mean that they are saved from hell, they have salvation, or it could mean they're being saved in childbirth. Those are the two possibilities, and neither one makes sense. And so, basically, save it for a Bible study, because we could argue about it, but there's no answer. One day we'll get to heaven, and God will tell us. That's one of those things. So that's why he doesn't want to give you the answer. He could say, hey, maybe I can't tell you, you won't understand. Maybe this Christian over here has a question. I'll explain to them and see if they understand. But there's no answer for it. So I don't think it's very honest to say you can't give the answer because it's not.
No, I gave it. I just said that would be a good question for a Bible study.
Can you give an answer to the Christian so they can understand, and then I just won't understand?
I did.
Okay, let's take a question for Eric. We'll get to you guys. Go ahead.
So I wanted to clarify something. When you said about,
I want to close by something.
Moral
laws are natural truth.
So you're saying they're set in stone, right? They can't change.
So they're set in stone, they can't change.
You're giving yourself a lot of leeway, and you're saying, oh yeah, this is how it is. But
you're giving yourself a lot of leeway, so you're saying that this is how it is.
In 100 years, we could interpret it wrong, but in 100 years.
So in 100 years, you could interpret it wrong, and then it could be right.
Yeah.
I mean, sorry, I just want to continue. And then Christians went out and killed people because they wouldn't become Christianity, and they thought
it was completely right. So Christians went out and killed Christians went out and killed people because they didn't believe in Christianity.
And when you look at it now, when you look back, you say they were wrong, but they thought it was completely right.
When you look back, you say they were wrong.
I don't really get it.
Yeah, and today we have other faiths doing the exact same thing. Killing people because they don't turn from what they believe to what this other culture thinks that they should believe. Is that right or wrong? I've had evolutionists call me up and say, I'm going to kill you, and then continue on some language that I won't repeat here because I don't believe in evolution. So what are we going to judge the evolutionists that do that? What are we going to judge the atheists or the Muslims or the Christians that do that by? Yes, that is wrong. It was wrong then. It is wrong today. It'll be wrong in 100 years from now. Again, let me go to an extreme example. Or let me just answer the question. First of all, yes, moral laws are absolute. They don't change. If you think they do, will there ever be a time, and I'm going to take an extreme example to make the point very clear, will there ever be a time that molesting children for fun will be right? No, they're set in stone. And it's actually a good thing because it allows all of us collectively to say, you know what? That's what's right. Everything else is wrong. It is a good thing to have a moral compass or a moral guy. I did have a question when it kind of comes to this, because Bernie brought it up again. I said, look, I used to have a relationship with Christ. I used to be a Christian. As a Christian, did you have a relationship with Jesus Christ?
I thought I did.
Did you have a relationship with Jesus Christ? Yes or no?
I thought I did at the time, just like you do. Yeah.
So if you now say you thought you did, but you didn't, were you ever a Christian? Because as a Christian, it's all about having a relationship with Christ. So if you say, I thought I did, but I didn't, then let's, like I said, you never were a Christian.
I have all the feelings. I feel like I was led by God.
Man, drug addicts have feelings. I don't care about feelings.
I felt like I was led by God. I felt like God gave me answers.
Feelings don't matter. What I'm talking about is truth. Did you have a relationship with Jesus Christ?
At the time, I thought I did.
Okay, did you or not? Yes or no?
Well, it's kind of like an American Indian, you know, they might have a relationship with a tree or rock because they think there's spirits in there, but there's no spirits in there.
Oh, so you weren't really a Christian. Because Christianity is having a relationship with Jesus Christ. If you now deny that you had that relationship, you're denying that you ever were a Christian, which is my whole point.
I was just as much a Christian then as you are now.
Now, when I was 21, you could have said the exact same thing. But at the age of 23, Jesus Christ took out my heart of stone and gave me heart of flesh, granted me repentance, and I have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ.
I said the same
thing. Did you ever have a personal relationship?
Yes.
You did that.
Yes, and I preached it. Yes.
So you did have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ.
I thought I did.
That's the problem.
All right, we'll take more questions from the audience for Bernie. Go ahead, in the hat.
You said earlier that basically humans or whatever we are, basically I'm a programmed meatbag.
Meat-based computer?
Yeah, that's what it was. Meat-based computer. So then my question is that arises, I mean, it's a classic question about what makes me any different than any other organism on this planet. Why are the chemical reactions in me different than in a tree and a plant? You know, I look at just in my lifetime how much humans can change their thinking. I mean, the iPod I had 2 years ago is now a dinosaur. That's how fast, you know, it's getting faster. And I look at animals and they're different. Why are humans so different?
If we're
just a programmed piece of meat, what makes us any different than that?
And the question that was stated was, so if we are a meat bag, why is what's going on in our heads, in our brains, how is that any different from any other animal or any other thing? How is that different?
Our mind emerges from our brain. We have a more complex brain, so we have more complex thoughts. We're not the best of all animals on everything. We don't have the best teeth. We can't outbite a lion. We don't have the best claws. You know, we're going to lose some animal fights. We don't have as much muscles as a gorilla. But when it comes to brain, we have a more complex brain. We are animals that have filled our ecological niche. So basically, our mind arises from our brain. Animals have brains. They know how to survive. They know how to avoid death. They even have rudimentary signs of morality. Like I said, Franz de Waal's book, Pioneers and Philosophers, How Morality Evolved. It's a really good book.
Okay. Do you mind if I ask you a question about that? Is that okay? My question to Bernie would be, what is your mind and where is your mind? What and where are your mind?
This is an important principle I mentioned earlier about emergence, and you can look it up with Ursula Goodenough, but basically our mind emerges from our brain. So
what is it?
Okay. Trying to understand it really is an interesting philosophical and scientific area right now. In philosophy, they call it the mind-body problem. How can thoughts give rise to, how can chemical reactions give rise to thoughts? And it's a really interesting area of research. This is what neurologists are doing. So again, you know, we just don't want to go to the God of the gaps thing where it's like, oh, I don't know, God did it. I mean, and again, the principle of emergence, I mean, the mind is, we think. Your brain waves happen because...
So where does it exist? Where is your mind?
It emerges from your brain, so it's from your brain. If your brain's gone, your mind's gone.
So
just
it's
like
inside?
Your heart pumps blood. Where does blood circulation? Well, it's because of your heart. It depends on your heart. Your brain is an organ. Like, your heart pumps blood, your brain does thinking. That's the goal for that organ.
Okay. I would, in relation to the God of the gaps, I think it's very interesting. If I asked you, what's 2 plus 2, what would your answer be?
4.
Oh, you guys are just 4 of the gaps. God is not God of the gaps, if it's the right answer. By the way, God is not just the God of the things that we don't know. God is God of the things that we do know. He's the God of everything. The gaps that we don't know, and the knowledge that we do have. Because without God, you can't know anything at all.
Okay, we'll take a question for Eric. Go ahead. You.
First, I just want to say that this is more of a philosophical discussion than a science discussion. It's kind of weird that we're doing this with science, but okay. It's a two-parter, but it's a really quick question. Would you claim that you don't know everything?
Would I claim that I don't know everything?
Yes.
I do not know everything in the universe?
Good.
Correct. I do not know everything there is to know.
So by your own logic, how do you assert your belief in God when you don't know everything, since something might contradict your own claim? Now, if you assert that God is putting something inside me, so I just spewed it out, that's still a claim within yourself. So how do you get out of that loop? Because we seem to all be in that same loop.
Yeah, his question is, how do you get out of this loop that if you say that you can't, if you don't know everything, you can't know anything? And my claim is that without revelation from God...
That's still an assertion that you're still asserting. You're asserting
right.
Revelation.
How do I know it? Because God has revealed that to me just as much as he's...
And you're still asserting.
Let me answer it. I know.
You're in the same loop.
All right. Hang on just a second. I really am going to answer that. How do I know that God exists? God has revealed that to me, just like God has revealed that to everybody. You say, that's a circular argument.
Yeah.
Hey, every single ultimate authority is inherently a circular argument. I would ask this, are circular arguments absolutely fallacious? You're not allowed to answer because you're only allowed to do one question, but my question would be, and you can think about this, are circular arguments absolutely fallacious? And they're not. There's a difference between a virtuously circular argument and a viciously circular argument. Let me give an example. If I brought a meter stick, and I had a meter stick right here, and I said, ladies and gentlemen, this is a meter stick, and you said, Eric, how do you know that? And I went, oh, hey, here's another meter stick. And I went, look, they're the exact same length. That proves it's a meter stick. And you said, oh, but wait a minute, Eric, how do you know that one's a meter stick? I say, let's go to the store real quick and let's buy another one. We bring it in, same length. You go, wait a minute, I'm catching on here. How do you know that one's a meter? We're going to have what's called an infinite regress until we get to our ultimate authority. Your ultimate authority for the meter stick is going to be a bar of metal that is in France. It's bolted to a plaque. They said, that's a meter. If we walked up to that bar of metal that they classified as a meter and said, well, how do they know that's a meter? We would say, because it's a meter. That's a circular argument. Well, you're right, it is. It has to be. Any ultimate authority is inherently a circular argument. We know that's a meter stick because that's the definition of a meter stick. It's a meter because it's a meter. In the same way, here's what I do. My out, because as Bernie has already said, he's denied knowledge. He's denied that we can know things. He said, I could be wrong about everything. If you could be wrong about everything, then you don't know anything at all. My out is revelation from God. You say, how do you know God has revealed it? Revelation from God. Well, how do you know it was revelation from God? Revelation from God. Here's what we've gotten to. We have now reached my ultimate authority, the revelation that God has given to us and all mankind. If I instead turned it around on you and said, okay, how do you know that reality even exists? I'm not doing this. I know, I'd love to. Believe me, I'd love to, but this is a debate between Bernie and I. If I turned around and said, how do we know reality exists? You say, well, we sense it. I can perceive reality. I can then go to the infinite regress of that to find out what your ultimate authority is. Hey, how do you know that your senses are valid? How do you know they're accurate and valid? Are there people in the world today that do not have valid senses? Their senses don't work properly. Yeah. How do you know you're not one of those people? Let me take it a step farther. Are there people in the world today that do not have proper reasoning? They cannot reason to valid conclusions. Yes. My question to you is, without without an out of God, without that, how do you know you're not one of those people? How do you know you're not strapped down in a psych ward right now and all this is going on in your brain? You don't. Without appealing to an ultimate authority outside of yourself, you're stuck in an inconsistent, illogical worldview.
What's your
Ladies and gentlemen, Ladies and gentlemen, God not only died to save our souls in eternity, He died to save our reasoning even now. It is unreasonable to say we could be wrong about everything, we don't know anything. Because you made a knowledge claim to even say that. That is unreasonable.
All right, question for Bernie. Yes, go ahead.
Before you go, I just want to make a really quick comment, 20 seconds. I think the circular, you accepting circular arguments is a major flaw in your whole philosophy. I think what you should do rather is look at all the data and see what best fits that. What hypothesis best fits that? That's called in science parsimony and parsimony. What's the most parsimonious? Also has to do with Occam's razor when you come to do a hypothesis. And the meter stick is not circular logic. It's defined. Like you said, there is one defined, and that's it. It's not circular. That's it.
So who defines reality?
Somebody arbitrarily. Whoever it was, they defined it. There's no circular logic. That's
so your reality can be different than my reality.
Whatever's at the Standards Bureau, that's the definition.
So it's can your reality be different than
it's
my reality?
Picked. It's not measured against anything. So that's all I want to say.
It's a circular question.
I have a two-part question, I guess you could say. My first question is very fast, quick, and simple. It's a matter of yes and no answer. Do you believe in survival of the fittest?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, how can morality exist with that? Because if I was on your side, and if I was also to believe in complete existence of survival of the fittest, you know what I would do? I would evolve. I would kill everyone who I don't like. I'd kill you for not being sure if you are wrong or right. I would become leader, and I would lead everyone the way I wanted to, because survival of the fittest. I got the guns, you don't, I got you. If you got me, well, that sucks.
Just
survival of the fittest. There is no, there cannot be morality with that kind of system, because you don't know what is right or what's wrong, because whatever happens is evolution.
Well, actually, that's an argument against God, because even a lot of Christians accept evolution, and now they have to understand how do you accept evolution in theology. This is called theodicy. It's the problem of evil, and it's intense, and it shows how it's inconceivable to believe in a God given evolution. I think, oh yeah, and then Eric said the same thing. I think if, you know, he wasn't a Christian or there was no God, he would just go out and do whatever he wanted to do. I said the same thing as a Christian. I remember talking to an atheist and said, you know, if I wasn't a Christian, I could just go out and do anything I want to. And as an atheist, I find that that's not the case. For one thing, consequentialism is a huge deal. You have your reputation and you want to stay out of jail. And if you want to have good relationships, you have to behave in a certain way. Go ahead and kill everybody. See what's going to happen to you. You're not going to last very long. You know, it's not going to work. It's not as bad as you think it's going to be.
I just want to point out that survival of the fittest is actually a logical fallacy of begging the question. If I said, how do you know that it was the fittest? You would say, well, because it survived. Well, why did it survive? Well, because it's the fittest. It's actually begging the question. It's a logical fallacy. It should be called survival of the survivalist. That's all you know. You don't know that it was the fittest. I mean, if a whale goes through and eats 90% of a school of fish, 10% survive. You don't know that that was survival of the fittest. That was more like survival of the luckiest. When the planes crashed into the Twin Towers, that wasn't survival of the fittest, was it? There could have been some incredibly fit people in there that died. That's not survival of the fittest. It's a circular argument that begs the question.
Question for Eric.
What is your evidence with God? Do you have because whenever you have God talking to you, it's just one part of your brain actually talking to yourself.
Sounds like Max has been talking to this young man.
It's his son.
I know. What is my evidence of God? Well, Dad's okay with this. The proof of God is that without God, you can't know anything. And that's exactly what we've seen here. is we've seen somebody say, I could be wrong about everything. They've given up knowledge in order to deny the God that they know exists. And that's why the Bible says it is so foolish to deny God.
So you're saying if I don't know what one thing is, I don't know what everything is.
No, I'm saying if you don't know everything, then you can't know anything to be absolutely true.
So if I don't know everything in the world, then I don't know that you exist?
Unless you have revelation from somebody who does know everything. And that somebody that does know everything is God.
So
and young
man,
if
I don't know, so that means if I don't know everything, that means that I don't know if God exists.
You can't know anything. You can't even, yeah, you can't. The argument, and I'm sorry, Max, thanks for trying to get a, how old are you, buddy?
This was not me.
How old are you? 11. To get
he's
into
been
11,
raising his hand the whole time.
That's fine. And I do appreciate, and these are good questions, but the argument is actually kind of simple. It just says, look, you would have to know everything in order to say you know one thing to be absolutely certain. Or somebody who does know everything could reveal something to you so that you could be certain. Here's, we all deal in the realm of certainty. We deal with 2 + 2 = 4. You don't go to the bank and ask for change for a $100 bill and then give you $5 and go, huh, I guess it changed. No, you go based on certainty. If I, for example, what was your name?
Chad.
Chad, if I knew everything there was to know, if I had all knowledge and you didn't, and there was a rule that said, I am never, ever, ever allowed to tell a lie. And I said, Chad, I know everything. I'm not allowed to lie. 2 + 2 = 4. Could you now know that to be true, even though you, Chad, don't know everything? Could you know if I knew everything?
I know that 2 + 2 = 4.
Right. If I knew everything and I couldn't lie and I told you 2 + 2 = 4, could you trust that to be true?
Yes, because yeah. I know it. There's
right.
No proof for it.
But
there's no proof for God.
Well, could you be wrong about that, Chad? Your dad said he could be wrong about everything. Could you? And I'm not just trying to pick on you because you're an 11-year-old young man. Could you be wrong that there's no proof of God?
No.
You cannot. That's an. So you're absolutely yes. sure of that. You're absolutely sure.
Yes.
I don't think your dad would take the exact same position.
I'm pretty sure.
But that's okay.
Okay. Thank you. We'll take a question for Bernie.
Good job.
What about these
things? Yeah, I'm still trying to figure that out. Go ahead.
Okay, for Bernie, since you say you don't believe in God because you're a evolutionist, and let me ask you this, do you believe George Washington existed, like he was alive? Do you believe that?
I didn't say I don't believe in God because I'm an evolutionist. I say more clearly I don't believe in God because there's no evidence for God.
And why do you believe George Washington existed? I mean, like, you didn't touch him, you haven't felt him. Just history books, and if you believe in that, if you believe in the history books and everything, why don't you believe that the Bible is right and it's true?
Well, I'm working on a lot of scholars. Just a couple things. For one thing, relatively speaking, it's relative new in history. I mean, it's not like 2,000 years ago with Christ or 3,000 years ago with Moses or something. So it's rather recent, and scholars who study this stuff say, yeah, there's lots of evidence. They have things written by him and everything. I came to the conclusion there is no good evidence for God, and the best evidence is God of the gaps, and that's why I came up here. This is why, what's your evidence for God? And it's origins. This is God of the gaps stuff. There, as far as a worldwide flood, scientifically it's disproven. As far as God making humans by a miracle, it's disproven through evolution. So all these things have been disproven. So he's going for evidence as God of the gaps.
Okay, we'll take a question for Eric. Go ahead.
All right, so you mentioned logical fallacies earlier. And my question for you is, do you think it's even possible for you to validate your claim of creation without the use of logical fallacies?
Can I validate my claim for creation without, say that again,
without
validating?
Without relying on logical fallacies.
I don't rely on logical fallacies.
Yes, you do. I've been keeping track.
On my claim?
Yep.
Okay, let me ask you this. In an atheist worldview, are logical fallacies absolutely fallacious?
I think that's kind of a weird question.
You're accusing me of having some logical fallacies in this debate tonight. My question to you is, are logical fallacies absolutely fallacious? Are they absolutely wrong?
See, you're using another one.
No, it's a simple question. You're accusing me of using logical fallacies. I'm asking you, are logical fallacies absolutely wrong? And you won't give me an answer. Because in your worldview, they're not. My worldview, where God says don't lie because he's not a liar. That's why the law of non-contradiction exists. A cannot both be A and not A at the same time and in the same way. Because that amounts to lying, and God is not a liar. The laws of logic are a very reflection of the way God thinks. How does the material world come up with an immaterial law of logic? It cannot. How come the laws of logic can't change? Is the law of non-contradiction absolutely true?
Okay, you're not.
Let me ask this. Do you believe in the law of non-contradiction?
Explain to me what you mean by the law of non-contradiction.
A cannot both be A and not A at the same time and in the same way. A car cannot be both in the parking lot and not in the parking lot at the same time and in the same way. My iPad cannot both be on the table and not on the table at the same time in the exact same way. A law of non-contradiction. Does the law of non-contradiction exist?
Okay, so this is a philosophical question that has to do with like the Schrodinger's cat type of deal.
No, it doesn't. It's simple.
Yeah, it does.
Does the law of non-contradiction exist?
You want me to give a yes or no answer, and that is not the most honest answer I can give, so I'm not going to answer that way. Sorry.
So there is. You can't answer yes or no. Here's the problem. If you say no, let me just tell you. If you say no, the laws of logic
let
do not
answer.
Exist.
Answer the question.
Then I would.
Let him answer.
Questions. Answer.
Hey guys, let me just talk.